Giant cell arteritis is a serious disease that can have severe complications from blindness to strokes. And if you don't uncover the early signs of this disease, if you don't know how to diagnose it and how to treat it, then you may end up with severe complications. In my last 15 years as a rheumatologist, I have diagnosed and treated many patients with GCA or giant cell arteritis. And to this day, I'm still surprised when patients do not get the diagnosis sooner and they end up with losing vision in one or both eyes. Giant cell arteritis, or GCA, it's a type of vasculitis. And if we break down the word vasculitis, you will realize that it comes from vessels and itis, which means inflammation of the vessels. So giant cell arteritis is an inflammatory condition affecting the blood vessels. I want you to think about blood vessels like a network of roads with highways, those being the large vessels like the aorta and temporal arteries, with streets, these are the medium vessels, and driveways, and these are the capillaries. And this network of roads delivers oxygen and nutrients to your entire body. In vasculitis, the inflammation causes these blood vessels or the roads to swell, to narrow, or even block completely, cutting off the blood flow to vital organs and to tissues. The most affected vessels in giant cell arteritis are the temporal arteries and other brain arteries and the aorta. In the United States, it seems that more females than males are affecting, and also the greatest risk factor remains aging. Giant cell arteritis almost never occurs before the age of 50. But the incidence rises steadily and the peak is between the age of 70 and 79. Something else interesting is that if you are of Scandinavian descent, then you have a greater risk for giant cell arteritis. Now let's find out what are the early signs of giant cell arteritis. Headaches. This is the most common symptom. This is reported by more than two-thirds of patients with giant cell arteritis. But unlike typical headaches, these are severe, persistent, and it's often localized over the temples. Patient frequently describes scalp tenderness, saying that it hurts just when they comb their hair or when they touch their heads. The headaches can also be located over the frontal area or occipital area. They can be on one side of the head or both sides. They can be subtle in the beginning or they can come and go, but they can also progress to be worse and worse. If you never had a history of headaches and if you have this persistent headache, especially over your temples, then call a doctor because this is not normal. Jaw pain or jaw claudication. About half of the patients with giant cell arteritis experience jaw pain. If you feel pain or fatigue in your jaw while you're chewing or while you're talking, this could be a red flag. The pain in the jaw and the fact that you must stop chewing food while you're eating, it is not always because of TMJ arthritis. But headaches and jaw pain aren't the only clues. There are also other signs of giant cell arteritis. Patients will often complain of being fatigued, experience night sweats, lose weight, or have a persistent low-grade fever. And they also start to have that general feeling of feeling sick. About 20 to 30% of patients with giant cell arteritis develop neck and shoulder pain and stiffness. Their symptoms can look like polymyalgia rheumatica. Polymyalgia rheumatica is an inflammatory arthritis that may affect the shoulders, the neck, and sometimes the hips. It tends to start suddenly with pain in the shoulders and in the neck, and then the hips will be involved in a couple of weeks. Sometimes the symptoms are more gradual and develop over the next few weeks. Patients will have severe morning stiffness in their shoulder or in the pelvis area. They will have difficulties raising their arms up to put something on a shelf or to dress or undress. People will have problems getting out of the bed and getting to the restroom. What is specific for polymyalgia rheumatica is that morning stiffness will always last more than 45 minutes to an hour, but will gradually improve with movement as the day goes by. Some patients first develop the polymyalgia rheumatica signs, and then in a few weeks or a month, they start to develop headaches, jaw pain, visual changes, which will point more towards giant cell arteritis rather than polymyalgia rheumatica. If polymyalgia rheumatica is painful, the GCA is dangerous and requires immediate intervention, especially when patients complain about visual changes. The most common visual change reported are blurry vision or spots in the eye field, or even short periods of vision loss. We call this amaurosis fugax. But any visual changes are a sign of emergency. That means that the eye arteries are affected and the treatment needs to be started immediately. Why? Because if the treatment is not started immediately, the patient may lose vision in their eyes and there is nothing to be done after this happens. And I will repeat this as I think it is very important to understand. Once permanent vision loss occurs, it is irreversible. In some patients, other brain arteries could be affected, and if it's not treated immediately, they may develop a stroke. Now that you know the signs, you might be wondering, how can we confirm if it's giant cell arteritis or if it's something else? When I meet a patient where I suspect giant cell arteritis, I carefully listen to their symptoms. If they have headaches, tenderness of the scalp, over the temporal areas, or if they had jaw pain, pain with chewing food, if they had low-grade fever, rheumatica-like symptoms in the shoulders or in the hips, I think about giant cell arteritis. And then I will perform a physical exam, I check the temporal arteries, I want to see if I feel the pulse in that area, if there is tenderness reported, and sometimes the arteries are obvious because they are swollen, and you can see them under the skin that they are inflamed. I will check the radial arteries in the wrist as they can be affected. I will check the heart to see if there are any murmurs. And the next step will be to order blood tests. And there are two key blood tests that I look to detect inflammation. One is erythrocyte sedimentation rate, or SED rate. In giant cell arteritis patients, it's often greater than 100 millimeters per hour. And C-reactive protein, which is another marker, and those two can confirm if there is a lot of inflammation. But lab tests are just the beginning. We will also do imaging tests to take the diagnosis to the next level. Imaging test is also important and necessary. We can use a test called ultrasound of temporal arteries. And the advantage of this test, it is that it is non-invasive, and it can show the thickened, inflamed artery walls, which is the hallmark of giant cell arteritis. We can also do an MRI or a CT angiogram of the brain, where we can see the inflammation in larger vessels like aorta or the temporal arteries. But now, the gold standard test that will confirm the diagnosis is the temporal artery biopsy. How is this done? A surgeon will take a small piece of the artery and then we will look under the microscope. If the vessel wall is inflamed, we will make that diagnosis. But in some cases, the biopsy can be negative because this disease does not affect the vessel as a whole. It may skip some areas. So if the biopsy was done in these areas, then it can be negative. Now the question is, do we have to wait for the confirmation of the temporal artery biopsy to treat? No. Ideally, the patient should get the biopsy done about 2 weeks after the diagnosis, but that should not stop us from treating giant cell arteritis, and it is actually safer to treat rather than wait for the biopsy results. Why is it so important to diagnose giant cell arteritis early? Because the complications are severe and often are irreversible. I already told you about the permanent vision loss, but giant cell arteritis can block the blood flow to the optic nerve, causing sudden and painless blindness. Studies have shown that up to 20% of untreated giant cell arteritis patients will experience vision loss. And then another complication that I fear for my patients is stroke, because inflammation of the arteries can reduce the blood flow to the brain, increasing the risk of stroke, especially in the back of the brain. And more rarely, but not impossible, giant cell arteritis can cause inflammation of the aorta, which will weaken the walls of the aorta, and that will lead to aneurysm and dissections. This is why giant cell arteritis is a medical emergency and will require immediate attention. But the good news is that giant cell arteritis is treatable, and if you intervene early, you can prevent these complications. How do we treat it? High-dose steroids is the first line in treatment. Patients will typically start with 40 to 60 milligrams per day. And prednisone is incredibly effective within just a few days. The symptoms like headaches, like jaw pain, like morning stiffness often improve within a few days. However, the long-term steroid treatment is not the long-term solution. High doses or long-term use of steroids can cause significant side effects, including weight gain, high blood sugar, mood changes, sleep issues, and even bone loss like osteoporosis, and will increase the risk for fractures. So after we start the steroids and we are able to control the inflammation, the goal is to taper down steroids gradually and to introduce a more targeted therapy. And the next in line for treatment in our days is tocilizumab or Actemra. Tocilizumab is a biologic drug that works by targeting a protein called IL-6 or interleukin-6, which is a key driver for inflammation in giant cell arteritis. Tocilizumab will block IL-6 and in this way will reduce inflammation. Now, accordingly to a study published in 2016 and another study in 2017, they were published in New England Journal of Medicine, and this is one of the most prestigious medical journals in the world. Adding tocilizumab through an injection weekly or every other week, combined with the prednisone, was better than just tapering steroids down alone. And it resulted in a more sustained remission period for patients with giant cell arteritis. Yes, this drug has been a game changer for people with giant cell arteritis because it will allow patients to taper down steroids more quickly and to safely control the disease. Now that you learn about giant cell arteritis, I want you to learn about polymyalgia rheumatica, because if you don't, you might miss this subtle connection between these two diseases and you might suffer unnecessarily. And these are critical insights that could save you time and prevent complications. So I'll walk you through everything that you need to know right in this video.